Coming up on Eyewitness 12 News tonight, Super Sunday is highlighted by major touchdowns. First, the former hostages land on American soil and are reunited with their families. Second, the Oakland Raiders outscore the Philadelphia Eagles to win the Super Bowl. And the Marymount teachers will strike unless they settle their dispute with the school board by midnight.
Sunday, January 25th, 1981. This is Eyewitness 12 News. Tonight.
Good evening, everyone. Here's what's happening in our world tonight. In a day of many events in both news and sports, the top story of the day, perhaps the year, even perhaps this new decade, they're home at last. A plane dubbed Freedom One, carrying the 52 former American hostages, touched down at Stewart Airport in Newburgh, New York, at 2:54 p.m. today after a flight of almost 10 hours. It began in Germany and included a refueling stop at Shannon, Ireland. They were immediately reunited with their families, then taken to the U.S. Military Academy at West Point for 2 days of secluded rest. We have the story of their homecoming from ABC's John Martin.
Freedom One touched down at Stewart Airport about 11 hours after leaving West Germany. Military police kept reporters and television crews away from the terminal. From a vantage point, they could see the former hostages come off the plane to greet about 140 relatives at the edge of the runway. Later, they entered a hangar and met for almost an hour before boarding buses for a 17-mile ride through streets and roadways decorated with flags and ribbons. People lined the route to welcome the reunited families. In Highland Falls, at one edge of the hotel, people began assembling around noon to catch a glimpse of the families. Among them, enterprising salesmen offering flags, buttons, and ribbons for sale. But some items were free. Children and parents climbed aboard a motorized train. As the motorcade approached, bystanders crowded to the edge of barricades. A yellow reminder that despite the aura of circus that was beginning to emerge, the reunited families had come for another reason, to be alone, together. Then they entered the Thayer Hotel and police sealed it off behind them for 2 days of privacy, their first as families in the 449 days since the Americans were taken hostage. John Martin, ABC News, West Point, New York.
Only 51 of the ex-hostages will be staying at West Point with their families. Sergeant Regis Reagan will be staying with his ailing mother in Johnstown, Pennsylvania. Reagan's mother apparently suffered a heart attack after talking with him on the phone last week from West Germany. It is not known whether Reagan plans to join the other freed Americans Tuesday in Washington for the official welcome from President Reagan. America has to be proud of you. These are the words of President Ronald Reagan, his eyes filling with tears and his voice choking with emotion as he addressed the families of the former hostages in the White House today. Larry Persinger, the father of former hostage Gregory Persinger of Seaford, Delaware, told the president that he had helped to put the icing on the cake as they all sat and recalled the personal strain of the past 4 months. Dawn Roeder, a 9-year-old daughter of former Lieutenant Colonel David Roeder, told Mr. Reagan that she had sat on the laps of both Frank Sinatra and entertainer Ben Vereen at the inaugural dress rehearsal, but it won't be as much fun as be back in the lap of her daddy. The president told some of the 139 relatives that he would not be making the trip with them to New York for their reuniting. He said that, quote, you don't need any outsiders, unquote, and at this moment is for you and for them. But this Tuesday, both the president and the rest of the country will have their say in a grand welcome home ceremony in Washington. We have this look at what's being planned.
On Tuesday, the freed hostages and their families will be back in the public eye. Just after noon, they'll land at Andrews Air Force Base to be greeted by Vice President Bush, Secretary of State Haig, and Defense Secretary Weinberger and their wives. They'll then board buses for the White House. The motorcade route will at times closely parallel that taken by President Reagan following his inauguration last Tuesday, the day the hostages were released. It will pass beneath the west side of the Capitol building and eventually run up Pennsylvania Avenue. There, the freed Americans will get a clear view of the Treasury building, which became one of the focal points of the last-minute negotiations to free them. The returned Americans will then enter the White House grounds and be greeted in a manner normally reserved for visiting heads of state. Details are not yet final, but the hostages can't expect the red carpet treatment literally. They will be welcomed by military honor guards, cannonades, and the other displays of pomp and circumstance that Washington so well provides on noteworthy occasions. The freed hostages will then have their first chance to meet with the man whose inauguration was made unique and especially memorable because of their release. After the reception with President and Mrs. Reagan, the returnees and their families will spend one final night in Washington before dispersing to Nebraska and California, Ohio and Virginia, and all the other cities and states from which they come. And then they'll be home at last. Steve Shepard, ABC News, Washington.
With the hostages safely home, the discussion in Washington today was what the U.S. should do if something like the Tehran takeover ever happens again. Former Secretary of State Edmund Muskie thinks unilateral military action would be less effective than steps by the international community to quickly punish any country that takes diplomats hostage.
Any country which entertains that kind of option again in the future ought to be clearly aware of the consequences in terms of its relations with the rest of the countries of this planet.
The man who negotiated their release, former Deputy Secretary Warren Christopher, was unusually blunt when asked about the future of U.S.-Iran relations, calling Iran's actions a disgusting and vile act, and said that it would be a long time before we see a normal relationship with that country again.
Back to the days when men were men and the law of the land was a six-gun during Blazing Guns Week on the big movie. Don't miss the original Lone Ranger, Monday afternoon at 4.
Aren't you going to H&R Block?
Who needs Block? I use the 1040A, the short form.
But is that the best form for you?
It's the one the government mailed me.
The long form might save money if you paid interest on an auto loan.
I did.
Or property tax? Medical expenses?
We use the income tax form that saves you the most money. At H&R Block, we'll make the tax laws work for you.
Now, who needs H&R Block?
Marymount school teachers will be out of the classrooms tomorrow morning and on the picket lines. The teachers' executive committee yesterday sent a telegram to the school board outlining four basic issues to avert a strike. Paul Harley, a spokesman for the teachers, told Eyewitness 12 News that the board is dragging its feet, and unless the board contacts the Teachers Association by midnight tonight, the strike is on. This would be the first strike in the village's history. Teachers are urging parents to keep their children at home tomorrow, but the school board says that operations in all Marymount schools will continue as close to normal as possible. A South Fairmont woman has been charged with felonious assault in connection with a shooting late this afternoon. Police say Annie Small of Northside apparently shot her neighbor, Claude Henson, Jr., after an altercation. Henson is in critical condition at Good Samaritan Hospital tonight with a gunshot wound in the head. Police are still investigating the incident. Jerry Hacker is in fair condition tonight at General Hospital. Last night, he was apparently involved in a robbery at the United Dairy Farmers store on Harrison Avenue. After a chase with police, Hacker was shot by a police officer while trying to escape custody. His accomplice, Michael Miles, was arrested and charged with two counts of aggravated robbery. The second charge stems from another robbery at the UDF store on Glenway and Rutledge. Charges against Hacker are pending. Campbell County police have arrested three men in connection with a robbery of a shop quick store in Mentor, Kentucky tonight. Details of the holdup are not clear, but nearly $1,200 is still missing. Police are not releasing the names of the three suspects, and their investigation continues. The Northern Kentucky Drug Unit arrested a West Covington couple late last night and charged them with trafficking narcotics. Police say Bob and Tina Vickers were taken into custody at their apartment in the 600 block of Pike Street. Police say they confiscated a large amount of drugs. Bob Vickers was released on $5,000 bond. Both will go to trial this Wednesday afternoon. And a near disaster was averted this afternoon at Lunkin Airport. A Cessna 150, piloted by Dan List, was making a landing attempt when the nose gear on the plane collapsed. The plane skidded to a stop. Luckily, no one was injured in the slight mishap. The plane suffered minor damage, including a bent propeller and a dented wing. The Cessna was owned by the D-Arc Flying Club.
look at it, Gino's new crisp and tasty frozen pizza has the crust you can trust. Make the Gino's blindfold test.
Okay, hold it. I'm sorry.
What's the problem now?
The whole thing just a little pushy. You know, the floor is already pushy enough. I mean, you got Gino's all over the place.
May I add two words to my own commercial?
Whatever.
Trust me.
Thinking of buying a wood-burning stove? Here's your chance to save 50% or more. The Dun & Laird Company, manufacturers of Wonder Warm stoves, is having its first ever factory direct sale at Watson's. These stoves are second, scratch and dent, and overruns, but all carry the full factory warranty. $700 freestanding stoves from $300. $900 fireplace insert stove from $300. $1,000 furnace add-on stove from $400. Bring your truck or trailer to Watson's. Check newspapers for details. Come to Watson's for the Dun & Laird factory direct sale for the buy of a lifetime.
It's no wonder Heritage Oldsmobile Cadillac has fast become the area's largest Oldsmobile Cadillac discount center. Heritage now covers nearly 12 acres and growing. Here's why. You can buy this brand new 1981 Cutlass Supreme six-cylinder at Heritage for only $66.39. And equipped with a diesel engine, it delivers 34 miles per gallon highway. That's Heritage. Heritage Oldsmobile Cadillac. Big discount center, just 5 minutes north of I-275 on Route 4.
Tonight, John Wayne and Rock Hudson star in the saga of a divided country.
Well now, Thomas, would you care to make this unanimous? With pleasure, Colonel Langdon.
Believed to be the first of its kind in Cincinnati, a scholarship fund has been set up for a daycare center. The New Adventure Preschool in Avondale has established a scholarship fund to assist those parents who are unable to afford a preschool education for their children. The fund is being named in honor of Mrs. Clara Williams, who is the school's cook. The preschool provides daycare service for 40 children from Avondale, Walnut Hills, and Clifton communities. 45 area girls tried out, but only 6 got the nod. I'm talking about the Vegas Follies. 6 dancers who will be the opening act at the new Las Vegas Supper Club in Erlanger, Kentucky. The ladies, who range in age from 19 to 24, will perform 2 acts per evening, bringing to life forms of tap, jazz, and ballet dancing. Today was their first rehearsal, and it appears that things are shaping up nicely. The girls will be dancing in full regalia opening night, February 24th, with headliner Phyllis Diller. I recently returned from the sunny Caribbean, putting together a 5-part series on the love boat syndrome that's sweeping the country. And I guess I brought some of the sunshine back with me. It was a beautiful day. You can believe it. Can it be January? Right now, let's take a look at the statistics for the day. Our high today was a fantastic 61 degrees, 40 the normal for this time of the year. Our overnight low, 30 degrees, 22 the normal. Right now, it's a comfortable 54 degrees in downtown Cincinnati with winds out of the south at 18 miles an hour. The humidity 49%, and the barometer is falling at 29.69 inches. Rainfall for today, none. River stage is 27 feet. Now for our exclusive AccuWeather forecast. Calling for tonight, partly cloudy, breezy, and mild. The low, only 43 degrees. Tomorrow, changeable skies, breezy again and quite mild with the chance of a shower. The high, 57. Tomorrow night, partly cloudy, turning colder. The low, 28 degrees. Tuesday, variable cloudiness, breezy and colder with the chance of a sprinkle or a flurry. The high, about 40 degrees. And on to Wednesday, partly sunny and a high of 37 degrees. Now looking to Thursday, some sunshine, a bit milder, and a high of 43 degrees. Well, Don, how you been?
I've been just fine, George. How about
cold,
you?
Right?
Anything new in your life?
Well, it's so sunny today, I thought I'd sit outside for a while.
Yeah, you look none the worse for the wear after that very tough assignment you had out there. I'm looking forward to seeing the type of work you did.
Well, someone had to
love
do
boat.
It. It was a great time. We'll be back in a moment.
Interesting, but doesn't your husband have ears?
Huh? Oh, I mean my smock. Yours, I just washed this.
Oh, whose is whose? Maybe I can tell. Feels soft. Smell.
Fresh.
If it feels really soft and smells April fresh, it's got to be Downy, so it's mine.
Downy rinses in softness. Freshness helps rinse out static cling.
Well, I'm getting Downy. Hear that, honey?
April fresh Downy.
They took their name from a divine typhoon that saved Japan from the Mongol invasion. In battle, they carried family swords of great antiquity. They wore the traditional hachimaki headband to symbolize samurai courage. Most of them were little more than boys who wanted to die like men. They were the kamikaze. You'll meet them along with the Americans who met their challenge when you find this announcement from Time Life Books. It's in your Sunday paper, and it invites you to sample the epic series that brings you face to face with men at war. This reply card brings you Volume 1 of World War II for free examination. And see this print collection of authentic fighter planes? We'll send it to you as a gift if you find the kamikaze's plane on your card and cross it out. Like this. The kamikazes and the Americans who stopped them come alive in your Sunday paper.
We can afford any of the new high-mileage cars we want if we sell our house.
American Motors knows prices, not just interest rates, are stopping you from buying a fuel-efficient car. So the tough Americans and their dealers have just cut their margins to reduce list prices 10% on every high-mileage Spirit, Concorde, and four-wheel drive Eagle. While others raise prices, the tough Americans give you a 10% price rollback.
Save on a new Eagle, Concorde, or Spirit today at your all-American AMC dealer.
John Matuszak, he was given up as weird. Jim Plugkin, he was given up on as dead. Ten Hendricks, well, they just gave up on him in Baltimore, and then Chris Barr. All of them finding bliss in Oakland, this group of nonconformists, they combine to bring glory to the Oakland Raiders as they defeat the Philadelphia Eagles, Super Bowl 15, by the score of 27-10. This is the third play of the game, and Rod Martin picks off one of his Super Bowl record three passes here. And what this does, of course, is set up this touchdown. This is third down and goal. They tried a couple of running plays to Van Egan. Quick little scramble. And there's the old reliable Cliff Branch. Now, he's been around a long time as far as the Raiders team is concerned. Rodney Parker pulls in this touchdown pass, but it's not a touchdown pass. This is the way things went for the Eagles, called back on a motion play. So the next series, the Raiders get the ball. The Eagles still aren't on there. Herman Edwards trying to pick the ball off. Nothing in front of Kenny King now except Bob Chandler. Look at that perfect block by Chandler. Just enough to screen the man off, get King in with no penalty whatsoever. That's a Super Bowl record, too, the 80-yard touchdown pass. Now the two-minute drill at this point, trailing 14-3. The Eagles go to Harold Carmichael. Here's the attempted field goal at the end of the half. Ted Hendricks, his 23rd field goal block of his career. The scramble is on there, and finally Oakland comes up with the ball. 14-3 at halftime then. Chris Barr, the former Bengal, puts him on top. Now at this point, 24-3. This followed a Cliff Branch touchdown reception of 29 yards, but still, Jaworski won't quit. He eludes the pressure there of the safety blitz and finding his man downfield, Charlie Smith. That's a 60-yard pickup, and here in the fourth quarter now, he hits his big tight end in the back of the end zone, but that's as close as they'll get. 24-10, another field goal by Chris Barr from 35 yards. And then this, the third interception by the 12th round draft choice, Rod Martin. Remember, he picked one off against the Cincinnati Bengals about the middle of this year. This will wrap it up right here as Martin goes down. That's the final score, 27-10. Mark Van Egan had 80 yards rushing. He was the leading rusher, and Jimmy Plunkett was 13 out of 21 for 261 yards. Remember when he came on Monday Night Football and he had just a great game? Everybody was saying, man, Plunkett looked good, but you could never imagine that a man who just threw 15 passes the past 3 years would be named MVP of the Super Bowl, go 13-2 on the year after stepping in for Dan Pastorini, who broke his leg. Congratulations to the Oakland Raiders, who win Super Bowl 15. Let's reminisce a little bit more here now. Remember when Martina Navratilova took the court for the first time this week? Seems like ages ago. She went up against Beth Hur, and she told me afterwards that she felt like the villain beating the hometown girl, but Martina was anything but a villain. She's absolutely marvelous, a joy to watch on the singles court or doubles court. I got to see her play singles five times, and she is just so fluid and graceful. She belongs on a tennis court. Cincinnati's Avon Tournament, well, this is a beneficiary. It is complete. The number one seeds prevail in both the singles and doubles. Martina beating another left-hander, Sylvia Haneke, 6-2 and 6-4. The doubles team of Jordan and Smith winning in three sets. We begin with singles.
The singles champions seem destined here, a champion for the Queen City to be proud to claim for the next year. The number three player in the world, number one seeded Martina Navratilova. She lost just one set during this entire tournament. She rolled in the first set today, breaking on top quickly, pinning the sixth-seeded Haneke to the baseline. winning with her ferocious all-around play, both at the net and from the baseline. 6-2, first set, Martina.
It's the best that I've played for a whole year, since the last Avon. Since about March, I think I had one good tournament in April, and since then I really haven't been able to play my best tennis, but this is it's coming back, so I'm happy about that.
The second set, Hennecke, the 15th-ranked player from West Germany, changed tactics. She came to the net often, meeting with frequent success.
I was surprised that she didn't come in more in the first set because she's got such a good serve. But then when she did, I returned really well. The best time she came into the net was during a point, and she had an approach shot. Then she had a chance to win the point.
At 3-all in the second set, Martina broke Sylvia. Navratilova then served out for a 5-3 lead. Hennecke held her serve to cut it 5-4. Then Hennecke took a 15-40 lead in game number 10. However, Navratilova saved the game points, still 5-4 instead of 5-all. Then Martina had four match points of her own before finally wrapping up the set with the match in the Cincinnati Avon Tournament Championship with 6-2, 6-4.
Game set, match.
I was number one, and I thought it was the greatest thing in the world. Well, I got there, and you know, I was sort of flat. It wasn't as great. Now I want it back, but for different reasons. I just want to be the best because I want to be the best, not because I just want to be number one.
Martina winning $30,000 and also a lot of prestige here for the Cincinnati tennis stuff. I mean, if you can say that you're a champion for the entire year, you can say for a year Martina Navratilova is a defending champion here. That lends your tournament a lot of class, which it was at the Coliseum. Now, in doubles, Martina and Pam Shriver were cut off at the pass by the number one seeded team of Ann Smith and Kathy Jordan.
Smith and Jordan, considered the top team in the world, ran into Navratilova's momentum and Shriver's fine play in the first set. 6-1, Navratilova and Shriver, the number two seeded team, having no problems. But then Smith, a native of Dallas who averaged 30 points a game for her high school basketball team, and Jordan, a Stanford graduate by way of Pennsylvania, and also Smith's equal as an athlete, came back hard. They won that second set 6-3, taking advantage of their team experience and Shriver Navratilova's inexperience. This was the first time that Shriver Navratilova had played together.
We just said, just play each point, you know, because if we get a break, we're right back in there. And that's what happened in the second set, and we just kind of had to start over, just say, forget the first set.
The final set, Smith and Jordan open up a 5-2 lead. Jordan with two match points on her serve. She eventually loses the game. However, the team turns around to win it the hard way. They break Pam Shriver's serve. Cincinnati Avon champions for 1981, Kathy Jordan and Ann Smith.
So we just said, run into the flower beds, run under the seats, do anything, but get that ball back over the net, because give them a chance to miss it.
Ranked number 16 and 23 in the world, they beat the number 3 and the number 9 player. That's where Shriver is. Also, ironically, Ann Smith did beat Kathy Jordan in singles in the first round of this tournament back on Monday. Jordan had been the number 5 seed, but they made up today easily because they split $11,000. Now, tomorrow we'll take a final look at that tournament. We'll wrap it up and put it to bed for good. Have a chat with Betty Stova and Hannah Mandlikova, and we'll have another feature piece for you. A couple of other sports stories for you. David Graham, he looked like a winner. He went 6 under par 30 on the front nine, so he had a 3-stroke lead at the Phoenix Open. Then Lon Hinkle got real hot. He tied Graham, but not to be outdone. David Graham dropped a 4-foot birdie on the final hole to win that Phoenix Open. Hinkle himself just a stroke behind. He shot a blistering round of 63 today. In college basketball, Ralph Sampson proved to be a world beater and a Buckeye beater. 40 points in number 2 Virginia's romp over Ohio State, 89-73. In the NBA tonight, Boston beating Seattle by the score of, there's the score for you, 115-106. That's 12 straight now for the Celtics, 24 out of 25. Robert Parrish with 32 points. And despite all that winning, they still trail Philadelphia by a game in the standings. The 76ers are 44-9 after that 5-point victory over Phoenix. Washington beating New Jersey. Former Olympian Mitch Kupchak with 30 points and 16 rebounds. Daily double tonight at Latonia, or actually this afternoon at Latonia. They did race the thoroughbreds out there. 11-10, paying an even $100. George.
Okay, Don, thanks very much. We come back, we're going to show you how some music made some money.
Dr. J! 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 Chapstick.
Dr. J has changed his nickname to Dr. Chapstick.
Chapstick Lip Balm is serious medicine. It helps heal chapped lips and helps keep them from chapping in the first place.
Dr. J!
Dr. Chapstick to you. Chapstick has emollients to protect against the wind and cold. Even has a sunscreen. Hey, buddy, have a Chapstick.
Hey, thanks, Dr. Chapstick!
Wendy's has the taste.
Take the Wendy's fresh hamburger taste test. Do you like your hamburgers hot off the grill? Should your hamburger be made fresh from 100% pure beef? Do you like your hamburger nice and thick? Do you like your hamburger made to order with your choice of toppings? If you answered yes to these simple questions, you should be eating Wendy's old-fashioned hamburgers. Take the Wendy's taste test in this Sunday's newspaper and cash in on these good taste coupons.
We have the taste. That's Wendy's taste. We have the taste. That's Wendy's taste.
Hello, Gene Lehman, Riverside Ford. If you're looking for a good late-model, low-mileage used car, come to Riverside Ford. There's never any obligation. We're showing you a Buick, a 1976 Regal just-in-trade custom interior. Looks like brand new, full price, $3,195. We'll take your older model car, truck, and trade and arrange terms to suit your budget. We have 10 1980 Pintos. They have mileage as low as 6,000 miles. Beautiful little cars. The prices begin at $3,999 for a 1980 Pinto with automatic transmission. If you're a Thunderbird buyer, we have a 1979 T-Bird just in trade. Looks like brand new. Has all kind of extras, including stereo radio, low mileage, $5,895. Now, this is a 79 T-Bird, the full price, $5,895. We have one of the largest inventories of good late model, low mileage used cars in the Midwest. If you're looking for a car, we're looking for you. We'll see you real soon.
Area musicians and artists donated their time and efforts this afternoon to help those families stricken by the earthquake in southern Italy last November. Representatives from the Cincinnati Opera, the Cincinnati Symphony, and the College of Conservatory of Music put on a benefit concert at the Cathedral Basilica of the Assumption in Covington. Proceeds from the concert will go to the Italian Earthquake Relief Fund. And in case you weren't at the concert, here is a sample of what you missed. That's a nice way to end the newscast, and a nice way to begin it, too, with the hostages coming home.
Yes. They, of course, the Super Bowl did a lot with the in honor of the hostages today. Super Sunday's over there. We're into the old hangover Monday now, aren't we?
Again. Thanks very much, Don. That's all the time we have for tonight. Thank you very much for watching. From all of us here on the Weekend Crew at Eyewitness 12 News, have a good night.